Let's just put our hands up. Let's just get free in this place. Let's just worship the Lord. Lord, we just adore you. Lord, we just love you, God. Our hearts are on fire for you, Jesus. We just love you, Lord. And Lord, we just set our affections. We set our gaze, Lord. We set all of our love towards you, Jesus. We just want to pour our love out at the feet of Jesus tonight. I just keep just sitting here just feeling just that heart that Mary of Bethany had. Let's just pour our love out at the feet of Jesus. Let's just pour our offering of love out at the bridegroom, Jesus. Lord, we just thank you for your love, God. Just release your presence, Lord. I just thank you, Lord, that this has just been the last couple of weeks. I'm just going to say from the get-go, this has just been, the last couple of weeks have just been a real power encounter with the Lord. People have been having experiences with the Lord, even when they go home, even on Monday nights when they get home. And I just believe that the Lord is moving in power. He's moving in his glory. He's calling his people back to intimacy. He's calling us back to a place of encounter, to a place of love, to a place of just the bliss of knowing and experiencing God. And I just believe that those that go after him in spirit and in truth, the Father's looking after those who will worship him in spirit and in truth. He's closer than we even realize. He's closer than we can fathom. He's closer than our very breath. Lord, we just breathe you in. Oh, thank you, Holy Ghost. We just thank you for your love. We just thank you for your presence, Lord. Come on, just thank you for his presence. He's closer than you realize. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, get verbal, get loud tonight. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we thank you, Jesus. We thank you, God, that you want to be face to face, Lord. We thank you, God, that you want to be heart to heart, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that your love is better than wine, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that your love is near. Your love is pursuing the heart of your people. Yes. And so tonight, Lord, we just give ourselves over to King Jesus. We just give ourselves over to knowing, experiencing, and worshiping you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
emotions. I wanna know your thoughts. Oh, I press in near tonight. He invites us into the Holy of Holies tonight. He invites us into the secret place tonight. So press in, God, we press in you. We press in you, we need you. We gotta have you. Oh, the beautiful one. Oh, the beautiful one. Sing out your own song right now. See the good. Oh,
full of glory, Lord. Lord, just thank you for your love, God.
Yes.
Lord, right now, we just let our hearts just dance with you, Jesus.
Yes.
Oh, thank you, Lord. Come on, just close your eyes. Just let the Lord just carry you away. Song of Solomon 4, come away with me, my lover, my bride. Let him just carry you away just to an intimate place in the spirit in your heart. Zephaniah 3:17. Behold, I'll quiet you with my love. I will rejoice over you. Loud singing and dancing, says the Lord.
Wow.
I love it. Revelation 21 talks about the marriage supper of the Lamb, but Hebrews 12 says that we have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God. We get to live in the powers of the age to come, Hebrews 6 says. We can live in realities that haven't quite touched down on the face of the earth, but yet they can be now in the spirit for the believer. So Lord, right now, we just take part, Lord. We take part in the romance of God and man. We just take part right now, Lord. We want you, Lord, to romance our heart. I want you to say that, Jesus, romance my heart. I want to love you. The marriage supper of the Lamb, Song of Solomon 8, says it's the day of the gladness of his heart. Love you more, Lord. We just feel, we just experience more of your love, God. It's like tug of war. We just can't even win. We just try. Tug's even harder. Lord, we just enter into that divine romance between God and man. It's our joy to hear the voice of the bridegroom. Wow, wow, wow. In a trance, and then he saw a vision. John, Revelation 1, was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Just let him just take you in the Spirit. Just let him just carry you away. Let him just enrapture your heart with love. Wow. Rapture our hearts with love. Rapture our hearts of God. Wow. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Just love your presence, Jesus. We just love your presence, Jesus. From the Lord right now that there's just some among us that the Lord sees where you're at right now, and there's a, I don't know why the bridal thing is so big and so strong on us right now, but I just said, it says one of the other passages in Song of Solomon says, who is this who comes up from the wilderness? It's talking about the bride of Christ, talking about the bride, the mature bride of Christ. And I just feel like there's been some of us in the room, you've been in a season of wilderness. You've been in the valley of the shadow of death. But there's going to be a time, and I believe it's soon, as you encounter the heart of the bridegroom, as you encounter intimacy with God, people around you are going to say, who is this who comes up out of the wilderness? Who is this who comes up, not even smelling like smoke, coming up out of the sin of the world and the issues and whatever you face? you're going to come up with as a mature lover. You can have a first love encounter with Jesus, but that does not mean you've been perfected in love. Perfect love casts out all fear. We come out of the wilderness, the valley of the shadow of death, with the same fire in our eyes that Jesus has for us. It's one thing to just have a little emotion for Jesus. It's another thing to be a fully matured, manifested son and daughter of God. I like to think of it as the difference between dating Jesus and being married to Jesus for 80 years. Hosea 2, behold, I will betroth them to me, loving kindness and justice and mercy, and you shall know the Lord. Wow. You shall know the Lord. Well, tonight, Lord, we just love you. We just love your presence. Just keep coming, Holy Spirit. We love what you do, Holy Ghost. We love your presence, Lord. We just love you. We just adore you. We enjoy you, Holy Spirit. So just come and move and power, Lord. Release miracles, signs, and wonders. And we do, Lord. We welcome, Lord. We welcome the angelic ministry, Lord. We welcome heaven to come and touch down in this place. We just say on earth as it is in heaven in this place. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your presence, Lord. We thank you for your love. Love you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. I'd ask you to clap, but I just kind of feel like we're supposed to just kind of hang out in this for a little bit. How's that sound?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. But a very golf clap. Thank you, Stephen. Hallelujah. Snaps. How many of you know we got to have the high praises? Amen. I like that. You got to run around the room every now and then and swing from the chandeliers. And you also got to know how to go deep and intimate with the Lord, right? So, seriously, thank you, Stephen. Stephen's the man. And, man, we just got some. Yeah, broke it. So, we've got some amazing people around here. Amen. And Stephen's one of them. So, hallelujah. Welcome to the Love Revival Ministry Center. And thank you so much for being here tonight. Amen. Your guests, we're glad to have around. Amen. One other thing that I kept hearing, and how many of you know that God doesn't always speak audibly? I wish he did. I also, you know, as one preacher said that, you know, if God has to speak to you audibly all the time, must mean that you're not listening very well.
Yeah.
He's supposed to be the still, small voice sometimes, right? And so anyway, I was standing there, and so I'm just stepping out here. How many of you know that we have freedom? You know, me and Bill were talking about this earlier. We have freedom to step out, right? And no one's going to get stoned if you get a prophetic word every now and then wrong, okay? So if prophecy under the new covenant was completely perfect, if you messed up, we'd have to stone you. And it would be equal to scripture. Praise God, it's not. Amen? So, okay. But anyway, I was standing here, and I kept hearing the name Deborah. I kept hearing the name Deborah. Now, but you've been sure, if you've met someone here, is there any Deborahs in this house tonight? Okay, hallelujah. This is what I kept hearing, is that God is raising up Deborahs in the season. Ones that can hear the voice of God. You know, Deborah was a prophet, she was a leader, and she also put an end to an unrighteous leadership, and God used her. She was a woman, hallelujah. Come on, Jesus. I believe that. Fivefold amongst the ladies, amen. Us men, we've been functioning at 50% for the last, you know, 1900 years. In the early church, it was normal to have women apostles. You can look that up all throughout church history. I know maybe you've heard me share this before, but Puccini was, you know, the woman at the well, John 4. We know from church history, she was one of the first women apostles. She was known for miracle signs and wonders. She was a miracle worker. She led a band or a group, if you will, of hundreds of female apostles and prophets and evangelists that gave them heaven. Hallelujah. They were known for miracle signs and wonders. They tried killing them. They couldn't kill them. They tried burning them at the stake. They tried putting them in boiling oil. They tried putting them in a furnace. You know, they finally killed her. They threw her in a well where she met Jesus. Beautiful, huh? Pretty cool. So anyway, we believe in that. So anyway, I just bless you ladies to function and who you're called to be. Amen. It's amazing. So, hallelujah. A couple quick announcements. I am trying to get a speaker for this coming week just because I've been feeling it on my heart. And I won't tell you who yet, but hopefully I'll hear back from him. So we may have a guest speaker this coming week. But the following week, whatever that date is, there is a guy coming named Kevin Kazmini. Has anyone ever heard that name, heard of him? Okay. I'm actually not that familiar with him either. Normally, I don't bring in speakers unless I personally know them or I have a major recommendation from a friend and I look into it. You know, there's a lot of good things out there, but not everything is what you're called to do. Amen? You know, there's a lot of good stuff. And I really, you know, we have a lot of speakers here. I really handpick very intentionally, hear from God, who we're to have, you know, like what's not only who we're supposed to have, but what's the message for that season, right? You know, I really, if you notice there for like about 3 months, we had a lot of prayer movement, worship movement type people in because I feel like that was a culture that God was dropping in here, right? And so, anyway, this guy, Kevin Kazmini, my pastor, Bobby Alger, gave me a recommendation for him, and he's going to be speaking at Crossroads in Winchester that week. And anyway, Kevin was a Muslim and was radically against Jesus. And if I understand the story right, had a powerful encounter with God, gets born again, and he's just seen wild, wild miracles ever since. I mean, the dead raised, I mean, just really powerful stuff. So that's the, not this coming week, but the week after that. So be sure to come on out for that. It's gonna be really, really good. So evangelism's been going amazing. Oh, there's Adam, he's the cameraman. Evangelism's been going amazing. And I was here praying and, you know, being antisocial, and the evangelist came by and after they were, you know, given front royal heaven, amen. And we're telling some of the stories and stuff. So Saturday evangelism, 1 o'clock, it's amazing. And I asked Adam, I want him to share two stories. One about someone getting raised from the dead, not this past week, but, you know, another time, you know, just normal everyday life for Adam. Come on, Jesus, we love Adam. And and also evangelism this past week. What, you want to come on up and I'll watch the camera. Can we clap for Adam? We love Adam.
How's everybody doing tonight?
Good.
Yeah, it always feels good being a child of God. That's what gets me going every morning.
Amen.
I'm the son of the living God. We all love it.
Amen.
We'll all keep going.
Can you give me your microphone?
Yeah, I got it. Everybody's always getting home like, hey, what? All right. Well, Bryan wanted me to share a story. Something that happened probably, I'd say, about 4 years ago. It was one of my good friends, Mario, I grew up with, and he was going through a real bad time in life. And he was, and that's when, we, you know, I was real heavy in the drugs. He was heavy in the drugs. And we were IV and, of course, heroin. But that day, that time of life, his old lady left him after, and that was his high school sweetheart. And all that day, he just kept saying, I want to die, man, I want to die. And I was like, dude, don't say that, man, because you say that, the next thing you know, it could happen. He's like, I don't care, I want it. So lo and behold, later on that night, we were waiting for a dude to come back from Baltimore with a pack of heroin in. And the dude already called us on the way down. He's like, dude, man, almost there. He'd come back down the road. He's like, y'all got to be real careful with this stuff when we get it to you. And we weren't, I wasn't really thinking nothing of it. And I guess Mario, in his mind, he was like, yeah, there's my ticket, you know. So lo and behold, he took his whole pack, loaded it up, and fell out on the floor. I mean, instantly, you could tell the life was just completely out of him. And everybody, it was about four of us, we were all just panicking, freaking out. We're taking turns, like trying to do CPR, giving him mouth to mouth. Nothing was working. We even drug him, tried to drag him into the bathroom, but he was so big and heavy, I really couldn't get it. So I was just getting cups of water and coming out, splashing on his face. I'm sitting on his chest, like crying, just smacking the heck out of him. And then they actually come, the guy was getting mad at me, came up, smacked the heck out of me. He's like, you're hurting him. I'm like, he's dead, man. What the heck? You know? But four people done verified there's no pulse, no breath, no nothing. I mean, I don't mean to laugh, but I can laugh about it now. Thank God that it's done and over with. But, man, we were just sitting around, and people were coming up with ideas, like just to drag him out in the street. And one other dude wanted to take him to his ex-girlfriend's house and throw him in the basement. And I'd say at least about 30, 40 minutes passed by, and finally I just raised up, and I was like, man, I was like, let's try one other thing. And everybody's like, what? I was like, let's just get on our knees and start praying.
Come on.
And everyone pretty much there was like, well, we don't believe in God. And other ones like, I don't care. I was like, I don't care, dude. Everybody just get on your knees. Start crying out to God like you never cried out to God before, whether you believe him or not. So we got down on our hands and knees and put our hands on his chest. And I was the only one speaking, and I'm like, dear Lord, please, please bring my friend back in the name of Jesus. As soon as I said that, as soon as I said in the name of Jesus, he was like, ugh. He took one breath. But then it was like flatline after that again. And I'm like, no, dude, you're not going out. And I kept just smacking him, trying to give him mouth to mouth. About another 30 seconds later, he took another breath, and that repeated process for about 2 minutes. And then finally he came to, and he's looking up, and he's like, what the heck are y'all doing, man? And I'm like, dude, you have died. We're all crying, shaking. He's like, bull crap, get the heck off of me. We're like, dude, you've been out for like 45 minutes, no joke. And he wanted to argue to death, but after he came to his senses and realized, you know, like, he knew it was a miracle, and he still thanks God all the time. He still comes to my house all the time, and I share scriptures with him and stuff. He's still drinking, but he did get off the heroin. Thank God. You know, so that was an eye-opener. Thank the Lord. And I really believe, like, God's got something for that boy's life. Just the way he just keeps coming back, you know, just for that little bit of scripture here and there. And two, I don't ever give up praying for him either. I mean, he's my best friend. I love him to death, and I just thank the Lord, dude, that he's still here. But I had a lot of time to think about that myself, you know. Like, I wasn't a church-born person, man. I never gave my life to the Lord or anything. I always believed in God, but that showed me how powerful the name of God is. And even when I did come to God years later, like, I kept getting insecure, thinking, you know, like, Lord ain't going to use me. I can't go out and heal or save people or, you know, doing. But I started thinking back to this scripture, and it says, you know, Lord, it's talking about, I guess, when the end or when people die. Lord, Lord, ain't I prophesied, healed the sick, casted out demons in your name? And then it says, you with iniquity, I never knew you, get away from me. Meaning, going to hell, whatever. But that just, that shows, you know, even a believer of God or not a representative of God, the name of Jesus is so powerful that anybody can use it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Anybody can use it to raise the dead or heal the sick. So that was really an ego booster for me. And I mean, that was a whole nother line of mess, but thank God he's
alive.
Come
on Saturday. What happened Saturday?
Yep, on a Saturday. I came here, and Mandy had a new idea to take a piece of paper and write down thoughts that come to your head. And I had a Main Street gazebo train, and I had bushes and grass, but I didn't write them down. The other girl, she here? I don't think she's here. She also had train or something like that. But this is wild how this one worked, because we were looking all, I had wheelchair too, so when we got down Main Street, I seen the train, I seen all the bushes, I'm looking for a wheelchair, but we ain't seen none. Mandy spots a girl on crutches, like, you know, I mean, she was bad, scooting along, and I was like, well, maybe that's the girl that's supposed to be prayed over. So we go to walk up to go pray for her, and we get close up by the train, and it's like she just disappeared out of nowhere. And I'm like looking all around, like, where did she go? She's literally on crutches. Like, how did she get away from her? Yeah, just disappeared. And Mandy had, I guess, seen somebody else start praying for them, but I'm still blown away. Like, where the heck did this girl go? Like, looking all around. And finally, I look over and I see this dude up by the bushes. Like, he just, I don't even know how I've never seen that guy. Like, I mean, because if he was from a distance, you could have really seen him if he was looking, but I mean, he just blended in. I guess he's just sitting there like a statue just looking. But, anyways, I actually knew the guy. He was an old friend, and this dude is like, he is so ate up in the head from like drug abuse. You know, he ate like, he was the type that did a lot of LSD and pretty much like hallucinogenic drugs and stuff like that. And I heard like he was trying to work on getting clean, you know, through the word on the streets. But I went and asked him for prayer, and he kept beating around the bush and beating around the bush. And finally, I'm like, do you want prayer or not? He's like, well, sure, okay, I'll take some prayer. So me and Mandy, we just started praying. We took turns praying over him. And he tried to keep on going and talking to us about his life story, but you know, we just ended up going away. And later on that night, I was back in the backyard in the hammock reading the Bible like always, and see this strange vehicle pull up. And I'm like, who in the heck is that? And then all of a sudden that same dude pops out. He comes back and his eyeballs are like huge. He's walking up like Terminator, fast as crap. I'm like, what the heck is this dude going to do, man? Is he out with me or what? And he's like, man, you won't believe it, dude. I just feel so great. I don't know what's wrong with me. I just feel peace inside of me. He's like, you know, I've been studying every religion lately, every one of them, and I was thinking they all lead to one God. But, dude, I felt something off of this one. I was like, yeah, dude, that's the only way, you know, to the Father's through Jesus Christ, man. All the other religions are dead works, just the devil put out there to try to deceive and manipulate people. He's like, dude, I don't know what it is, but I feel good and I want more of it. And I was like, well, sit down, dude. I'll just lay you down, you know, the summary of the what I know, you know, of the Bible. So I gave him the summary of the Bible. And he was stoked, man. He tried to stay there all night. I thought he was going to, you know, asked to come in and lay on the couch or something. But I was like, dude, you just come back tomorrow or something. I'm kind of tired, dude. You know? Like, I'm already getting ate up by mosquitoes. Like, looking around for any bears or anything because we're on the edge of the woods. But it was great, dude. Just glory and honor to the Lord, man. And I just want to let y'all know, you know, like, I'm really a nobody. I have no degree. I'm new in religion, but it just shows that God has a plan for each and every one of us. And to just take that stuff out in faith, man, just the littlest things, dude. You know, I learned that we stop our own selves, but just going out there, man, I just thank God, man, and all glory to God.
But we prayed for addiction to go from this man.
Oh, yeah,
and we spoke like destiny over his life.
Yeah.
And he told Adam that he was actually waiting for his drug to come on the bench.
Yeah.
And that she saw us there praying for him and got spooked out and didn't go
out.
And he didn't really want to use drugs.
Yep. And so all that day, he didn't want no drugs. Yeah. That's amazing. Hallelujah.
Brian, can I add something to that?
Yeah, sure.
Well, we had a yard sale Saturday, and at this yard sale, I had to instruct the people that the main thing is to tell people about Jesus. That's the main thing. And so it was a sign put up, and it said, need prayer, stop here. Car swung in there, and all of a sudden, it's almost a parallel story. I've been to this place, I've been to this church, and it's just like, I want a church that has not took the book of Acts out of the Bible. I want a church that preached the true gospel of Jesus Christ, and went on and on and on, and people was coming, and on, you know who that was? His uncle.
Go, Uncle Jim.
That's awesome.
After he left, the next thing you know, he came back. And so I just had to say that. It's like parallel.
Yeah.
God's on the move. That's a couple drug deals we've broken up. Put them out of business.
Praise
so Lord. Good. So anyway, we're going to go ahead. That's amazing. I love that. You can do it too. We're going to go ahead and take up an offering. You need to see if you need to give by card. Mandy's right here. We appreciate your faithful giving. As we always say, we want you to keep your ties in your local church, but we have bills here too and have to pay the bills. Amen. So some really cool stuff going on that maybe I'll share at a later date, but be praying for a building. Be praying also, we may have a couple of interns, a couple of missionary interns bringing them along. Some really interesting things going on.
Yes.
I'll share later on.
Hallelujah.
But anyway, if you want to give tonight, we welcome you to do so. It is tax deductible, and I'll go ahead and pray for you as you do that. Lord, we just thank you for your love, God. We thank you for providing for your people, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that your children love to give, Lord, out of free will, Lord, and out of loving you, Jesus. So we just love you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to share a super quick word. You can go ahead and do that. You can bring it up. It's really cool. I'll start. I'm going to share a quick word, somewhat quick, and I'm going to teach a little bit. We're going to go through a lot of Bible. Who loves the Bible? Hallelujah.
Yes, hallelujah.
The Bible is my favorite book. It is the inspired word of God. Amen.
Amen.
And guess what? It should lead us into an encounter with God. It shouldn't be a killjoy. It should just get the party started, amen?
Yeah,
so,
amen.
You know, if you ever hear biblical theology that makes you want to go to sleep and not pray and encounter God, you're listening to the wrong theology. What is theology? Theology is the study of God. Not a piece of paper, not a book, not a history book. Theology, any type of theology, should lead you into encountering the heart of God. So, I want to share specifically tonight. Lately, I've been kind of more in preacher mode, but tonight I'll be in a little bit more teacher mode. I got two different sides of me. I got Pentecostal preacher mode, and I got teacher mode. I love being able to get a chair. I should have done it tonight. I got that high chair or whatever it is. And sit here and have a cup of coffee and just break open the Bible. See, I got to do that at Servant's Heart a couple weeks back.
Hallelujah.
And, I loved it. Reggie was there. I loved it. I love being able to do that. So, what I want to specifically share on tonight is speaking in tongues. Who here has grown up in a setting where you are speaking in tongues a lot?
Yeah.
Okay. Raise of hands. I'm just curious. Been in that culture. Okay. So, speaking in tongues. I think it's probably one of the most controversial religious or hated by religious people things out there. You want to find out if someone has a religious spirit about them, let them know you speak in tongues and just check their reaction. People can get mad. I mean, red in the face, mad. Even the Baptist church I grew up in, they didn't mind taking somebody to the basement every now and then and praying for healing. You know, they did James 5 way, which is, you know, bring the elders of the church, you know, pray for them, anoint them with oil. Even the Baptist church I grew up in didn't mind praying for the sick, but oh my goodness, if somebody would have walked in there and said, hi, I read the NIV and speak in tongues, especially the NIV part, but anyway, once for another day, and I speak in tongues, get out of here. You know, I mean, literally, they would have thrown them out. So, it's been a journey for me. I'm not going to act like, you know, I grew up, you know, coming out of the womb, just hallelujah, speaking in tongues from the moment, okay? It's been a journey for me. So here's a little bit of my personal journey. So you guys know my testimony. I got saved in an encounter with the presence of God. I was 17 years old. I started experiencing the presence of God. I would laugh. I would cry. I'd have dreams. I'd have all kinds of things go on in my room. And I'm like, okay, the Bible clearly states that the gifts of the Spirit are for today. And speaking in tongues is one of those gifts, so I want that. I want everything that God has for me, amen. And I'll go there in a minute, but 1 Corinthians 1, maybe it's chapter or verse 13, says, I pray that you would lack nothing. Everybody say nothing.
Nothing.
Or some translations will say that you would lack in no spiritual gift as we wait for the revealing of Jesus Christ. So nothing means everything, right? In that way, it means every single gift of the Holy Spirit is for you and is for me.
And I said, God, if you're my dad, you want me to have everything anyway, so this includes everything, so I want to speak in tongues. So I started asking Lord. I'd say, Lord, I want sounds kind of weird, gives me the goosebumps, but there's power on it, you know? And so one day at Liberty University, it was at the end of my freshman year, I just went through a really bad relationship. I had all kinds of things going on. I was on fire for the Lord, amen. But there was still this thing of like, I was like up and down. Does anybody ever, you know, sometimes feel like you get on fire and then you get out of fire, you know? Like, here's what the baptism of the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, okay, most people believe, and this is a little bit different topic for another day. What is the baptism of the Holy Spirit? I personally believe the baptism of the Holy Spirit is you being submerged, baptism, baptismo, being dunked in the Holy Spirit, right? So, you know, as you guys may remember, you know, there's water in this bottle, but the bottle's not submerged in water. If we drop this down in a pond, the bottle is now baptized in the Holy Spirit. So one of the earliest, this is just a fun fact for you, one of the earliest places in the Greek language we can find the word baptismo, Acts 1, and you'll be baptized in dunamis, power from on high, for and I will make you witnesses, amen, Acts 1:8. So anyway, baptismo, one of the first times we can find that word in Greek is a old Greek a recipe for pickling pickles. Who likes that? Want to go in a cucumber and come out a dill. Put me on the barbecue of heaven, Lord. I pray that all the time. I really do. I want to do it. So anyway, that's one of the first places. So most people would believe of the Pentecostal charismatic spirit-filled background would say the evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit is speaking in tongues. Now, there's some debate about that, and I'm not interested in debating that at all tonight. That's a whole other topic for another day. But simply the gift of speaking in tongues. So I'm sitting there in a prayer chapel, and I start reading Luke 15, and the Lord starts ministering my heart. I start weeping. I start encountering the love of God. I start feeling His presence. I'm like weeping. Like, I can't even begin to describe you. Like, colors got brighter. Life got more beautiful. I mean, birds were singing. I mean, it was like on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. Amen. And I'm sitting there, and this waves of liquid love are just washing over me. Like, this is literally the greatest feeling ever. Oh my God. I feel like thinking about hallelujah. I'm just losing it. It's a Baptist prayer chapel. You're not supposed to do that. You know, it's against the rules. And I'm sitting there, and all of a sudden, I feel this like heat, this like spiritual, supernatural, electric heat over my throat, and I'm like, is this the moment? I get to do the thing. I get to pray for speaking tongues. Hallelujah. And so all of a sudden I just feel like I just can't help it. I just start speaking in tongues. And I don't really remember exactly, but it wasn't like a lot. It wasn't like the most beautiful language. You know, here's some people, it's like they are like speaking Hebrew, hallelujah. It wasn't like that. It was like way more simple, but I'm like, God's kind of making me do it, and it sounds goofy and whatever. And so it was amazing. So now this is a common story for a lot of people. Here's what happened. So there's a common misbelief, and I want to have love and compassion. I also do want to come against a couple of religious ideas that aren't in the Bible, amen. It's so interesting what people will say is in the Bible. Yeah. They'll say, well, the word says this, and they'll quote you, you know, a novel or something. It's like, that didn't come from the Bible. God helps those who help themselves. Proverbs 37:5. I got that out of the book of Hezekiah. There is no Hezekiah in the Bible. So anyway, Proverbs ends with chapter 31. So he didn't get that from there. So anyway, one of the common misconceptions, and what I believe, was that, who's ever heard this, that the Holy Spirit will make you speak in tongues. Right here it says this way. I've heard people say this about worship too. People will say, I only worship that way, the way that so-and-so wildly worships, if God makes me, or if I feel God really strong. People will believe the same thing about speaking in tongues. They'll say, I only speak in tongues when I really feel God, or I really, He makes me do it. Okay. Well, that's an interesting way of thinking about it, but here's the problem. Is it a gift of the Spirit or is it a force of the Spirit? If I give you a refrigerator, you can throw it in your backyard and use it as furniture if you really want, but that's not what it's supposed to be for, amen? You get to choose, though. There is a proper usage, right? But you can also abuse it. I can give you a brand new car and you can trash it and put graffiti on it. It's still your car. It's still your gift. It's the same with the gift of healing. So you've heard me share the story that I just love. I have a friend that went to South Africa. He heard healings happen there. He never heard seen any healing, and he heard healings happen in Africa. So he goes to Africa. He didn't see any healings. And he's on the plane coming back, and he says, Lord, I didn't see any healings. I heard healings happen in Africa. And the Lord goes, how many people did you pray for? And he's like, none. I wonder what the problem is. So I speak in tongues in the prayer chapel. And then I go to speak in tongues, because I heard you're supposed to speak in tongues every day. As simple as a God pastor told me, speaking tongues every day keeps the devil away. So that's what I wanted to do. So I'm in my car, I'm on my way to class, and I'm like trying, and it's like awkward, and it's like weird. And I was like, that thing was so fun yesterday. That was amazing. And then now I'm like, this is like the weirdest thing ever. Like, what is this, you know? And then I started doubting it. And then I didn't speak in tongues for like a couple of weeks. And then, like, worship would be amazing, and like a conference, and I'm like, oh, thank you, Jesus, and I'm going for it, and I'm like, this is amazing. And then the next day, it would be back to nothing, because I'm sitting in class, and it's a boring day, and whatever. Here's what I learned. It's a gift of the Holy Spirit, and guess what? Gifts, the charismata, okay, charismata is the grace gift. How do you know grace is free, but to walk out righteousness is actually going to cost you something, amen? So God gives you the gift of righteousness, 2 Corinthians 5, you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, but you still have to choose to not walk in sin sometimes, right? He gives you righteousness, and you get to abuse it if you really, really want to, though that's a really bad idea, and it's a waste of time, right? Jesus is better. So the gifts of the Spirit are the same way. You get a gift of the Spirit, but you have to flex the muscles, amen? Paul, I'll give this as a little ahead of time, but Paul in 1 Corinthians 14 says, he who prays in a tongue edifies. Everybody say edify.
Edify.
Edifies himself. That word edify comes from the word they would use for building a house. How do you know you're a house for the glory of the Lord, amen? I want to give clear understanding of what is speaking in tongues tonight. And one of the most important things, there's warfare, there's intercession, groanings with which we can't understand. But one of the, and interpretation and missions and all those good things. But this is my focal point tonight, okay? 1 Corinthians 13 says that the gifts are empowered and work through what? Love. 1 Corinthians 13 is the love chapter. Love is like this, love is like this, love is like that, okay? So Paul, at the center of the gifts of the Spirit, says love is the first and the foremost. It's the centerpiece. It's the icing on top. It's the foundation. It's everything, amen? So even our understanding of the gifts of the Spirit and speaking in tongues should be bathed in, focused on love, amen? I meet a lot of Spirit-filled people sometimes, and I'll ask them, so what do you speak in tongues for? I don't know. Preacher so-and-so gave me the gift, and laying on of hands, and I get to speak in tongues, and worship gives good. Hallelujah! I get to do the thing again, amen? That's good, but edifying is talking about building a house. What are you? A house for the presence of God. Ephesians 2, we are being built together as living stones, as a holy and dwelling for the Lord in the Spirit. Do you not know that your bodies are temples? Everybody say temple. Temple of the Holy Spirit. So when we pray in the Spirit, I want to refocus you from just a thing of like, it's what us Pentecostals do, to you're actually building a resting place for God in the Spirit. Like Solomon had diamonds and gemstones and gold and silver. And when we pray in the Spirit, we sit in our prayer room and we say, God, come and touch me. Oh God, just build me up. You speak in tongues for 5 minutes. Well, however you do it, I'll give you some keys that work for me. Might not work for you, but good things for me personally. I feel like I'm adding diamonds to the walls, amen. Yes. A new beam just went in the house of the Lord. I mean, built up into a temple for the Holy Spirit. So you want to go in your Bibles to the book of, let's go to Jude. Jude only has one chapter. And this last part here is really what I'm aiming for here. Jude 1:20. But you, beloved, building yourselves up. That same word there, building, is what would be used in 1 Corinthians 14 for Edifying. Everybody say edifying.
Edifying.
Building the house. What's the house again? You. Let's review. Who's the house? You, the house. So building yourself, your inner man, building yourselves upon the most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. If you got the KJV, praying in the Holy Spirit. You say, you know, some will say, oh, praying in the Holy Spirit doesn't mean speaking in tongues. We're going to find out in 1 Corinthians 14. Okay, this will all be recorded so if I'm doing too much all at once. 1 Corinthians 14 says that praying in the Spirit and singing in the Spirit relates to speaking in tongues. So praying in the Spirit doesn't mean human language. Praying in the Spirit means a spiritually imparted, supernatural language that you are releasing to the Lord. Okay, so building yourselves up upon the holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit, keeping yourselves in the love of God. Look what happens here. He ties praying in the Holy Spirit to keeping yourself in the presence of the love of God, okay? How do you know while we were yet sinners, God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself? So praying in the Spirit doesn't keep God loving you. Do we get it? So while Adam is, you know, I love his honesty. You know, like he's like falling away from the Lord in this story. He's about to do heroin with these other guys. Praise the name of Jesus, and God raises the dead through him. Amen? So your performance doesn't do anything to the heart of God. You won't be in heaven one day, and Jesus walks out of the throne room and says, hallelujah, I love Lee a little bit more today. I got a breakthrough. I like him a little bit better. No, God's love is unchanging. While you were yet sinners, God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. How much more will we be saved by his life? We're saved by his death. Romans 6. Okay. So literally, you cannot change God's love. So this here where it says keeping yourselves in the love of God is not keeping God loving you. It's you walking and experiencing and walking into the love of God, as I like to say it. Sometimes when I'm praying, I like this, just my imagination. Doesn't have to be yours. Okay. We all, God works with us all different. I like to think of the love of God as a house. And it's my house, and it's big, and it's amazing, and God loves me no matter what. Amen. On my best day, on my worst day. But I do get to choose if I live in the house or not. Amen. You are one with God. Colossians 1, you've been filled with the fullness of God bodily. Amen. The mystic secret of God, of hidden wisdom and revelation. Colossians 1:9 lives inside of you, Jesus Christ, right? But you get to choose if you want to experience that love or not. You can run away from Jesus for the rest of your life. I think he's still going to live inside of you, but you know, but he's going to be really uncomfortable in there. You know, he's like, hey, let's hang out, amen? So keeping yourselves in the love of God. What's the idea? We sit before the Lord, and we say, come Holy Spirit. I love opening up the Bible. I love the Word of God. I love chewing on the Word of God, right? Ezekiel ate the Word of God, right? It was sweet to his mouth. Ezekiel, John both did that. And I like saying to the Lord, I said, Lord, I love you. Holy Spirit, come on. Find one of my favorite passages. Whatever your favorite passage is. And I'll say to him, I'll say, God, I just want to know your love. And I'll feel just the waves of God's love. And then I might speak in tongues for 20 minutes. And then all of a sudden, it's just like it increases. Like I'm going deeper in the river. Ezekiel talked about how the river of God, you can go in ankle deep, you can go knee deep, or you can go chest deep, or you can swim in it. Amen. It's the river that proceeds from his throne. John 4 says that this river would bubble forth. Everybody say bubble forth. Oh, that's why they say Kaiser's got the geysers. It says geysers of living water, right? It's a bursting forth. You know, Smith Wigglesworth would stand before Niagara Falls and he would just shout out it and go, God, burst forth through me the way you burst through this waterfall. Come on, that's what you want. So when you're praying the Holy Spirit, those waterfalls of love, that waterfall of the presence that proceeds from the throne of God, Revelation 21, and it's for the healing of the nations, Revelation 22. I love this. Come on, I love the Bible. It's so good. So anyway, praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, go down to verse 24. Now him who is able to keep you from stumbling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory ties the glory of God, the manifest goodness, Exodus 33 talks about the glory of God being equal with and the same thing with as the goodness of God, right? So before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. Anybody ever walked out of a meeting, you'll see somebody that's like, I felt God in this room. What God did you meet? I heard a preacher one time, very famous preacher, he said that when people walk out of church happy and say the presence of God was there, they're wrong. It wasn't God.
Come on.
He used, you know, Exodus burning bush as a prototype of the presence of God every single time. You know, God is good. He's been a dad for all of eternity. Like, before Creator, guess what Father God is? Father God. So when we have God come in the room, we shouldn't expect a rod in his hand. We shouldn't expect a dad who wants to play. That's going to stretch some of you.
Amen.
I got a story about that, but okay, rabbit trail. I love this story. It's going to stretch some of you, though. I have a friend who went up to the Toronto Revival. He's familiar with the Toronto Airport Fellowship and what God was doing there in 1995 or 94. My friend goes, and he came from a Pentecostal background. He was used to people running around the room, shaking and banging, but it was more like, oh, God's in the room. And he walks in, there's thousands of people, like, you know, just laying on the floor. And they're just like, ah, you know, just laughing and rolling and all these things. And he's like, what in the world? Like, you know, what he actually thought. He grew up Black Pentecostal, and he said, I didn't know white people got the Holy Ghost, you know. And so he's like, what in the world? He said, I think this is God, but I'm not so sure. There's some good things, but there's some bad things going on. He didn't like some of the manifestations. And he looks in the back, and there's a gentleman in the back. He's huge. He's like my height, big guy. And the guy, I kid you not, for my friend, I believe him, he's a good guy, is like imagine this open space. And this guy is like jumping at like an imaginary person. Like, he's like doing somersaults. He's grunting. He's like laughing. He's getting tickled, but nobody's there. I mean, he's doing some funky stuff. Look like WWE, but one guy. He's like flying around. He's like, what is going on? And so my friend's like, that is not of God. Somebody needs to cast that devil out of him. And Lord says, just watch. I'll show you what I'm doing. And he's like, no. This ain't God. I done picked up a demon. And the guy looked like a wrestler. So anyway, the next day, Toronto, they would always do testimony time. They'd see people shaking and something. They'd say, well, what's God doing in your life? Sometimes it wasn't God. Sometimes it was the flesh. But they always wanted to honor what God was doing. That, you know, anyway, that's a whole other topic, another preaching. But anyway, so this guy comes up. My friend goes, oh, boy, there's that guy. He's probably going to give a story about how the demon came out of him, you know, during his testimony. And the guy is weeping. He's laughing. He's crying. He's shaking. And it turns out the guy is a professional wrestler. I don't know who, but he was truly a professional wrestler. And he goes, I walked into this room, not even a believer. And I was standing in the back, and one of the biggest desires of my life was that my dad, my physical dad, would wrestle with me. He said my dad hated me, he would only abuse me, but he would never show any affection, he would never wrestle with me. And that's the way I wanted him to show his love. And the guy became a wrestler in real life because that was a wound that was in his heart. He's sitting back there, and Jesus, in his mind, right? Paul was the only one that heard the voice of the Lord, right? The other people didn't. Jesus shows up to him right in front of him and says, let's wrestle, son. And starts wrestling him, and he gets born again there on the spot. Come on, we got to be religious. So anyway, before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. Joy down in my heart. The joy of the Lord is our strength. 1 Corinthians 1. Let's roll through a bunch of passages really fast. We're going to go through almost all of 1 Corinthians 12, 13, and 14. Okay. I thank my God always concerning you, the grace of God which was given you in Jesus Christ, that you were enriched in everything. The Greek word for everything means
everything.
Profound. I know. I learned that at cemetery. I'm just kidding. I had to go to cemetery. In seminary. Enriched in everything, in utterance and all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that you come short in no gift. Who's ever heard it said? Paul has a rhetorical question, 1 Corinthians 12. We're going to go there. And they will just say, are all apostles, are all prophets, all the gifts of healing, do all have the work of administration? And they'll say, therefore, not everybody has those gifts, and you can only have one gift, and therefore, everything's closed. Here it is right here. Paul says, so that you come short in nothing, no gift, as we eagerly wait for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ. Has Jesus come back yet?
No.
Praise God, we're all Orthodox believers in the house tonight. Jesus hasn't come back yet, so therefore you're not called to lack in any gift. Case closed. Okay. So, how many, we all know now the gift of the Holy Spirit, the speaking in tongues, is now for you. Okay. 1 Corinthians 12. Let's go over 1 Corinthians 12. Here's another foundation. Here's two foundations I want to give you. How do you know context is key in the Word of God, right? You do not have the right to take the Bible out of context. Neither do I. And so what if the original learners, original hearers were hearing is the same belief or context or foundation that you should also have. You know, if a preacher comes up to you and tells you that, you know, when Jesus said this, said that, well, that's what he meant to that generation, but it's not what it means to you. That's not true. Anything that it could, here's a great Bible hermeneutic. Hermeneutic means the way you see or read or interpret scripture. Okay. Here's a great Bible hermeneutic. What it meant to the first century, or sorry, what it didn't mean to the first century, it cannot mean to you. You can't just say, well, the color red here in the book of Revelation means this. So I just, you know, it can mean different things in different generations. That doesn't give you the right to change it around, right? You got to hear what the first generation, the first century heard, and then get your doctrine from that, okay? Uh-huh. So with that in mind, 1 Corinthians is just one of many different letters that Paul wrote to the Corinthian church. Paul didn't write Corinthians and say, I am now writing a book of the New Testament. No, 1 Corinthians is literally a letter to the Corinthian church. We know from history that probably 1 Corinthians is only one of five letters. Most church historians and people believe that really 1 Corinthians, if you want to get technical, is really 2 Corinthians, and 2 Corinthians is really 4 Corinthians. They wrote a letter. 1 Corinthians is Paul's response to their letter, more so his rebuke. Most people believe that there was a third letter, their letter to him, and then 2 Corinthians is really 4 Corinthians writing back to him. Does that make sense? Okay, it's like an email chain, okay? So anyway, here's the context that we need to understand. Paul finds out these guys love the spiritual gifts. He actually tells them, he says, I don't want you to be ignorant of them, and I'm glad that you have the spiritual gifts. He already said, I don't want you to lack any of the spiritual gifts, right? And so he likes that. He likes that a lot. But he's also hearing that they are abusing or misusing the gifts. Here's another thing that the religious people sometimes do. They'll say, well, someone misused the gift or abused the gift, therefore the gift isn't real, or that church and that ministry is off or demonic or cultish or whatever, okay? That's not reality, okay? Just because someone messes up one time or someone in a congregation misuses something doesn't mean a church is bad. I can't tell you any time I've had people say that about churches here at Front Royal. They'll say, well, that church over there, one time somebody did speak in tongues with an interpreter. It's okay. It's all right. It's not ideal, okay? This is the new covenant. It's not the new law, okay? So just because someone in a congregation messed up doesn't mean Pastor so-and-so messed up, okay? It might be something outside their control, and they probably had a nice back room, take me to Jesus conversation afterwards. Okay, so Paul is not talking about your private prayer life. He's talking about the corporate setting. I've had people come to me and say, I heard someone speak in tongues in your ministry, and they didn't have an interpreter. I don't think you guys are from God. Okay, Paul's talking about, Paul didn't have a microphone, okay, but in our context, he's talking about the speaker. The preacher. Paul's not saying, Ruth, if you go in your prayer closet and you don't interpret it, you ain't of God, okay? That's not what he's talking about. He's not talking about what you do at home. He's not talking even about worship like this. He's talking about, okay, Bill, it's your turn to speak. You have the floor. You have the mic, you know, you didn't have a microphone, but you get what I'm saying. You got the pulpit. And then all of a sudden, Stephen stands up, starts speaking in tongues as loud as he can. That's what Paul's addressing. He's not talking about worship. He's not talking about, you know, even if I did this, I wouldn't have a problem with this. You might, but that's okay. You know, you'll love me. I'll love you either way, hopefully. You know, even right now, if I said, all right, everybody, let's just speak in tongues for 20 minutes as loud as we can. Personally, I wouldn't have a problem with that because it's not a speaker being interrupted. Paul's heart behind this is speakers being interrupted. Okay, it's not a religious thing of like, oh, that guy back there, he spoke in tongues, and that place doesn't know God. Okay, that's not what he's talking about. So anyway, 1 Corinthians 12. Let's just read on through, and we got a little context. Now, he says, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that you were once Gentiles, carried away by these dumb idols. Paul said, buddy, dumb idols. However, you were led. Therefore, I make known to you what that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed. And no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Wow, Paul had a real unity understanding that most of us Christians don't believe. You don't agree on eschatology. You're not of God. You don't believe on the same thing I do about lose your salvation or eternal security. You're not of God. Paul's simple thing is, if somebody speaks as Jesus is Lord, they're in the faith.
I don't even know if I agree with that, but Paul's like smarter than I am. So anyway,
verse 4. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. The differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but the same God who works in all. The manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. Everybody say corporate, okay?
Corporate.
Corporate. Paul switches around. The main context here, 75%, no, probably 80%, 90% of what Paul's about to tell us is corporate. But there are some hints of what the private speaking in tongues prayer life can look like, okay? Acts 2. That's corporate missionary languages, okay? There is a difference. The way I see it, I like to simplify it this way. There's two different types of speaking in tongues, okay? There is languages for the purpose of missions. I could tell you dozens of stories of people being in other countries, not knowing the language, walking up on a podium. God says speak in tongues, and all of a sudden they speak perfect Swahili, okay? I can tell you literally hundreds of those stories. I've heard hundreds of those stories. It's amazing. It's awesome. I believe it. But again, we're talking devotional speaking in tongues. Okay. Same Lord, different manifestations, gives one, profit of all, corporate, okay? To another, faith by the same Spirit, and the gifts of healing by the same Spirit. To another, working of miracles and prophecy, and another, discerning of spirits, and different kinds of tongues. There's different kinds of tongues, not just missionary tongues, okay? And to the other, the interpretation of tongues. Now still corporate, but one the same Spirit, who works all these things, dividing individually as he will. Okay, so he goes through, we're all the body of Christ. I love where he says here, let's go down to verse 27. Now you are the body of Christ and members individually. God has appointed these in the church. First apostles, second prophets, teachers, and after that, miracles and gifts of healing, helps. People say the gifts of the Holy Spirit have passed away. Is helps and administration still in the church? You better believe it.
Oh, yeah.
The church wouldn't exist if it didn't, amen? Baptized David, ask me, because I have a feeling neither one of us are very administrative. Hallelujah. Helps and administration are still in the church. So guess what? Apostles, prophets, teachers, pastors, evangelists, Ephesians 4, are still also to be in the church. Amen? Are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles? Do all have gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? But let me stop right there. Because normally that's where people will stop. They'll say, well, clearly not everybody, because Paul's doing a rhetorical question, but don't forget what 1 Corinthians 1:13, what did it say? That you would lack in no spiritual gift.
Yeah.
Paul's saying, yeah, currently you don't have all the gifts of the Spirit, but until Jesus comes back, I want you to seek after the gifts of the Holy Spirit. So he says, do all have the gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But earnestly desire the best. Yes. Some translations don't put that best in there. I'm not sure if it's even there in Greek. The New King James does. Who has a different translation? Does it say best in there?
No, greater.
Greater. Okay, some just say desire the gifts. Okay, so either way, same idea. And yet I show you a more excellent way. Again, remember what we talked about. He sandwiches all this in love. 1 Corinthians 13. Okay, you know 1 Corinthians 13. We've all heard it at like 17 weddings, so I'm only going to read part of it. Though I speak with tongues and of men and of angels. Let me read the first verse. Of men and of angels. Did you know you could speak in the tongues of angels? What does that mean? I don't know. I want to do it though. Maybe I have. I don't know. I do know of a man, a prophet, very legit prophet, who went to heaven one time and he went into the river of life and he didn't speak in tongues at the time. He started speaking in tongues and he was relating to and talking with angels in his encounter with God. Okay, maybe that's it. I don't really know, but I'd like to do that sometime. So Lord, do that. Okay. I become a sounding brass, a clanging cymbal. Okay, now, 1 Corinthians 13, you know that. I encourage you to read. It's an amazing passage, but for the purpose of what we're talking about, we're going to move on. Okay, 1 Corinthians 14, pursue love, and here he goes again. He says it three times to pursue love, and here's the third thing that he says, desire all spiritual gifts. Come on, did you hear it?
Amen.
Desire. Sorry, I read the all wrong. It says spiritual, and it has the A-L at the end, so I just read all. But it says, pursue love and desire spiritual gifts. Is there any limit to that?
No.
You know, at school I went to, university I went to, you know, we had to take spiritual gifts tests for like every class. Like, okay, accounting class, take a spiritual gifts test. And all the tests would like literally be like, I'm sorry, so lame. Like, every gift would be like, you're either like an administrator, a helper, or like you have mercy. And I'm like, tell me if I'm a prophet or an apostle. The gift of merit. I'm like, my atheist friends could take the same spiritual gifts test and get the same results as me. That's just natural human gift. That's not a gift of the Holy Spirit. That's just your personality.
Yeah.
Which can be related to your gifts of spirit, but not always. Okay. So he says, desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. I love that. And he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God. Anyone ever heard it taught that speaking in tongues is only for mission situations? Well, they didn't read their Bible. Okay. For he who speaks in a tongue doesn't speak to men, but to God. So praying in tongues is what? Speaking to God. Now again, there's missionary, right? Okay, languages. That's awesome. That's powerful. Also, you know, for Romans says that we pray with groanings. You know, that may be speaking tongues. Doesn't have to be, but it probably is on some level. I don't know that it. You know, some people say it definitely is. I don't know about that. But anyway, and then we have interpretive tongues. Okay. Now, if some of you grew up old school Pentecostal, you grew up around that pretty often. Okay. You know, I've been in services where it is really God. I've been in services where it's not God, but I've really been in services where all of a sudden there'll be a quiet moment, and Sister So-and-so stands up, and, I mean, this is, you know, speaking in tongues 20 minutes or something, and then all of a sudden someone else or her will get the interpretation for it. That's biblical, okay? That's awesome. That's powerful. Doesn't mean their interpretation's always going to be right. Now, for me, I came up kind of modern charismatic, where it's like a little bit more laid back, where you don't hear thus says the Lord quite often, but you do sometimes. And that's just my culture. That doesn't mean I'm right. That's just my culture, okay? For me, what that's looked like is I might be praying for someone, and I'll feel like the Lord has more for me to give them, and I'll stop praying in English. And I might pray in tongues for 30 seconds. And then all of a sudden, I will have revelation or a prophetic word or understanding about what I'm saying. And then all of a sudden, I might get a really accurate prophetic word. Though it doesn't look like the old school Pentecostal way where I might be like, in the name of Jesus, thus says the Lord. You know, like, you can do that. Praise God. I'm down for that too. I don't know. You know, like, I'm a little more laid back sometimes, you know. And so for me, it's more just I'm a quietly praying spirit. And then I'm going to give you a good prophetic word, hopefully, you know? So that's an interpretation there. Even though I know people that do that all the time, they don't even know they interpret tongues. You're interpreting your own, getting a prophetic word. That's why Paul ties the two together. You may prophesy and speak in tongues. He speaks in a tongue. He does not speak to men, but to God. For no one understands him, wherever his spirit, in his spirit, he speaks mysteries. Come on. Revelation. You know what the Greek word mysteries there is? Mysterion, which is where we get the word mystic from. You know, I'll see New Agers sometimes. They'll have tattoos that's like mystic, and I'll be like, hey, guess what? I'm a mystic too. I'll say, really? Where is your spirit guide? The Holy One.
Hallelujah.
He leads me into all truth. He's the comforter. He gives me this ability to lay hands on people, and they start laughing uncontrollably and feeling the power of the Creator of the universe.
Amen.
And I've laid hands on people at that moment, and they start literally just getting delivered or touched by God. Amen. So anyway, guess what? You're called to have mysteries. You're called to speak mysteries. So sometimes I won't know different theological things. I'll pray in the Spirit for 10 minutes, and I will all of a sudden understand what I'm thinking about or reading. Okay. In His Spirit, man, I'm going so over. Oh, boy. I can tell. This is going to be a two-parter, maybe. In His Spirit, He speaks mysteries. But he who prophesies edifies in exhortation and comfort of men. He who speaks in a tongue edifies. There's that word there again. Edifies. He builds up the spiritual house. He edifies himself. But he who prophesies edifies the church. You get the difference. He's talking corporate, secret place, prayer closet. And then he switches over to prophesying, right? It wouldn't do you any good, Paul's saying, for me to just stand up here and belt out in tongues for 30 minutes. It wouldn't do anything for you. But it will do something for me when I'm in the prayer closet, amen? When I'm alone with God and I edify myself, I build the temple of God up and pray in the Spirit and read the Bible and cry out to God, it edifies oneself, okay? And that's a good thing. Peter prophesies, edifies the church. I wish that you all spoke in tongues. Somebody circle that, highlight it, give it to your Baptist friend. Hallelujah. I wish you all spoke in tongues. Hallelujah. But even more that you prophesy. For he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks in tongues, unless he indeed he interprets, that the church may receive edification.
That's right.
But now, brethren, if I come to you speaking with a tongue, what shall I profit unless I speak either by revelation, by knowledge, or prophesying or teaching? Even things without life. Brother Blue, okay, goes through all that. Time-wise, I'm going to skip down just a little bit. Where do I want to go? Let's go to verse 13, chapter 14, verse 13. Therefore, let him who speaks in a tongue pray that he may interpret. Again, corporate. If I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays.
Amen.
Yeah, this, I'm just demolishing that idea that this is only for missions, okay? Or only for interpretation, okay? Why is your spirit praying to God and it's not releasing an interpretation? Why? Because you're building yourself up. So even speaking in tongues, even in a worship-type setting, singing in the Spirit like Stephen did, is not always to give it a prophetic word or an interpretation. Sometimes you're building yourself up in the most holy faith, like Jude says, right?
Yeah.
Therefore, let him who speaks in a tongue pray that he may interpret. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my understanding is unfruitful. What is the conclusion then? I love this. So where do you get singing in the Spirit from? Here it is. I will pray with my spirit. That's where we get the idea that Jude is definitely talking about praying in the Spirit. Okay, we connect the two. And I will also pray with my understanding. I will sing with my spirit. Hallelujah. I will sing with my spirit. And I also sing with my understanding. Otherwise, if you bless with the Spirit. So guess what else you can do with speaking in tongues? You can bless God. Amen.
Amen.
If you bless with your spirit, how will he who occupies the place of the uninformed say, amen, to your giving and thanks? What else can you do? Give thanks by speaking in tongues. Sometimes I praise God in tongues. I'll drive and just thank God. And let me say this. Let me rabbit trail just a little bit. This is a really, I think, an important thing, a helpful thing. Is you don't pray in tongues from up here. You pray in tongues from down here.
Amen.
You let the river flow, right?
Yes.
And so for me, you know, John 1 verse 18 says that Jesus came forth from the bosom or the heart of God, right?
Yes.
2 Chronicles 7 talks about how the heart of God would be in Solomon's temple, and his ears would be attentive, his eyes would see, and he would hear their prayers, right? So God has a heart, amen, and God has a center of emotion. What does that really mean? I have no idea. It's another divine mystery, and I like it. God has a heart. My dad has a heart, and yours too, amen?
Amen.
And so what I like to do, this is me personally, I like to, when I pray in tongues, I pray from here, but I focus on the heart of God. I don't just, you know, talk to the Lord, right? And he's that, amen, hallelujah. I mean, you know, you can relate to God in different ways. He's a bridegroom, he's a friend, he's a love. You know, you pray in different ways in different seasons. So when I pray in tongues, oftentimes, sometimes I'm doing warfare, sometimes I'm thanking God, sometimes I'm praising the Lord. But often, I am focusing in my mind's eye, in my spirit, on the throne of God, praying right into the affectionate heart of God. Amen? I tell you, that helps me out a lot. If I'm just praying in the air, you know, that's fine, that's dandy. But when I focus that I am praying on, I'm focusing on the burning heart of God, the fellowship of the burning hearts, as I said last week, right? And our new painting out there, be sure to check that out, I really like it. I am focusing on the burning heart of God, right? So that helps me out. I pray with my spirit, I bless with my spirit, and you're giving of thanks, for indeed you give thanks well, if others are not edified. I thank God I speak in tongues more than you all. Wow. The Apostle Paul, the dead raiser, the missionary of all missionaries, the writer of most of the New Testament, says, I wish you all spoke in tongues, I wish you were like me, and I speak in tongues more than all y'all. That's what he said. That's pretty cool. I like that. Okay, I think I'm good. I think that's about everything I wanted to cover there. Amen. Let's all stand up. Oh, let me read this. This is, yes, still stand up, but let me read this. I was like, I got restless leg syndrome. Let me stand up. Sorry, I went a little bit long, but
it's okay.
Everybody good? Everybody good? Good stuff there?
Yeah. That's good.
Everything good outside? You never know around here. All right, I encourage everybody, see this book here, everybody look. If you want to remember, it's on the camera. It's called The Glory Within by Corey Russell. This is a really great book about speaking in tongues, but also about identity and building that interior life in God, right? So this is a great book. Check it out on Amazon. He says, my friend loves to share a story of one of his first experiences with deliverance. He was attending a seminary at the time, and the professor invited him with a few other students to participate in a time of deliverance ministry as intercessors. They were supposed to sit on the far side of the room and pray in the spirit while the professor ministered to the individual. Well, as he and his fellow students began to speak in tongues quietly, the demons started manifesting. I've had that happen before. Demons don't like speaking in tongues. Sad religious people don't either a lot of times, but anyway. The man was thrown to the ground and started yelling at the intercessors to stop praying. They didn't like that. My friend was terrified. His professor, however, commanded the demons in the name of Jesus to interpret what was being spoken in tongues. In a voice clearly not his own, the man hissed, they're declaring the victory of Jesus.
Amen.
Come on. That's a demon could interpret what was going on. Greatly encouraged by this, students began to pray in the spirit with greater confidence, praying louder and in volume. Again, the man yelled at them to stop, and again, the professor commanded the demons to interpret the tongues. That's interesting. And they are prophesying our coming demise. I like that. And the man has this experience convinced my friend the power of praying in tongues in this spiritual warfare. Amen. Let's all just put our hands out in front of us. And Lord, we just thank you right now. Lord, we just thank you for your presence, Lord. We just thank you for divine mysteries, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your people being equipped, Lord. I just ask you for an impartation, Lord, of just revelation, knowledge, Lord, of the interior life, God, of building the temple of God in the Spirit, Lord. So I just ask, Lord, that you would just release your presence right now, Holy Spirit. And Lord, I ask you just edify us, build us up, Lord, as we pray in the most holy faith. Amen. Well, if you just want to dwell in the presence of God and put into action praying,